Good afternoon, everyone. Let me quickly introduce myself. I'm Vinodh Kumar. I'm currently the CTO and Managing Director of Bloomreach India. So the last, to give a quick context on this topic, right? So over the last 3.5 years, we at Bloomreach India have been building an e-commerce search engine called Snap, which is currently live on a lot of customers in the US, the likes of Sears, Staples, Walmart, etc. Prior to Bloomreach, I used to work at Google, where I was the tech lead for Google News ranking. I wrote most of the ranking code for Google News back then. So in this talk, what I wanted to do is to sort of draw on my experience working in the web world, the news world, and then, you know, the e-commerce world over the last 3.5 years, and sort of provide insights into the challenges, and then briefly discuss approaches on solving some of the problems in the e-commerce search space, right? So search engine, right? The moment we say search engine, right, the thing that comes to everybody's mind is Google. And talking of Google, right, can anyone tell me what this number is? Sorry? Yeah, so basically this is the total number of index pages in Google right now, at least a year back, right? So when you give a query, basically Google is searching 60 trillion documents and giving you the result. So suppose I search for NASA, what's the result that you expect? I see some people taking your mobile out. Don't take your mobile out. You don't want to ask Google about what will be your first result for this query, right? So what should be the first result for NASA? Sorry, wiki page of NASA, or? As for what? Or basically the NASA website, right? So does anyone disagree that this is a, does anyone think this is a bad result? Okay, right? So let's say the query is Turing, right? What do you think should be the result? Yeah, Alan Turing's Wikipedia page. So everybody agrees with that, or somebody doesn't agree with that? Yeah, maybe Turing test, but yeah, well, this is close enough, right? So tallest building in the world. Burj Khalifa, right? So this should be the result, right? Does anybody disagree? No, right? So let's look at what's the problem that Google is trying to solve, right? In most of these cases, there is one or two right answers, correct? And basically the challenge is to retrieve that one right answer for the query from a haystack. Like the problem is like searching for a needle in the haystack, right? You have 60 trillion documents, out of which you want to find that one relevant answer for your query. So now let's switch to e-commerce, right? So a typical corpus for most of our customers in the e-commerce is 1 million products, right? Just to contrast, right? If web is about searching a region whose area is equal to the size of Africa, then e-commerce search is basically searching an area of size of basically Cobham Park, right? So you can find the contrast, right? This is, if you can search the entire web, right? Is it a big deal to actually search Cobham Park, right? I mean, this is contrast the areas, right? So I think, so the question basically is, so how hard is building an e-commerce search engine? Is there really a problem of scale here? And is e-commerce search engine just a microscopic web search engine? So the pun is intended, you know, there's a million document here and trillion documents here. It's really a micro sort of a web search engine, right? Is that the case? So one of our big customers for Bloomreach is Neiman Marcus, which is a high-end fashion retail outlet in the US. Basically, most of the users on Neiman Marcus, customers on Neiman Marcus actually are women and really rich women. So, you know, we built a search engine for them, right? And we are live on their site. So let's understand this problem, right? Suppose a user queries shoes on this website. Neiman Marcus has 20 different categories of shoes, and from 100 different designers, and almost all of these designers are world-class designers. Like you name them, they are on Neiman Marcus. And basically they have 10,000 shoes in their inventory, right? So now, and so basically all of them are relevant. Unlike the web case, right? All of them are relevant, and there is no right result. So if I were to show you a set of 10 results and ask you, is this the right result? I'm not sure you guys will agree and say, yeah, this is the right result. You may have a different opinion of what should be the right result. So the problem is quite different here. The problem is one of choosing the first among equals, right? Or the best among equals. So how critical is this problem to solve, right? So to answer that question, let's look at this graph. So this is a graph that I constructed using data from most of our customers. Our customers are basically all of Amazon's competitors in the US are pretty much our customers, right? And what does this graph show, right? Suppose 100 people basically land on your site, right? Only 50, close to 50 people, right, actually go on to click and go to another page, right? By the time people have looked at three pages, right, there's only 25 to 30% of your visitors, right, have actually gone to the third page. And this is basically an exponentially decaying curve, right? So you're basically losing customers on every single page, right? So how many of you over here have worked on marketing or growth hacking? Anybody? Yeah. So you guys know how hard user acquisition is, right? And if you're going to lose 50% on every single web page, right, then basically that's not good, right? So basically, right, like most of e-commerce, most of the pages on e-commerce website, I call them search pages. Like one are the pages that are rendered explicitly after a query. Category pages are also search pages, which are generated using an implicit query, right? So pretty much an entire e-commerce website is about search pages. So if people are going to jump off the website at this rate, right, that's a lot of pressure on the ranking. You need to get it right. So let's try to design an algorithm, right, for building an e-commerce search engine. So what's going to be the page rank of e-commerce? Suppose we rank all the relevant documents. So we said there are 10,000 shoes. Right now, how do we rank them? Right? A very simple algorithm is to rank all the relevant documents by their sellability. Right? So we need to define sellability. So can somebody come up with like what could be a good sellability metric? Sorry? How many have sold? That's great. So anything else? Mm-hmm. Right. So let's start with something like let's start with the sold case, right? Let's define sellability to be revenue, right? So what are the issues with defining sellability as revenue? Exactly, new products. Yeah, you can handle out of stocks, but sorry. Yeah, right. So if you define sellability to be revenue, right? There's little scope for newer products to make it to the top, right? The all-time revenue garners will continue to dominate, right? And so what does this mean, right? That means that revenue cannot be all-time, right? You need to basically weight your revenue by recency. So revenue that you got from products in the last week are obviously more important compared to revenue that you got from products a month ago, right? Things are changing a lot in the e-commerce world. There are fashion trends, and even in electronics, there are new products released on a daily basis, so you can't look at all-time revenue at all, right? And the second issue is presentation bias, right? You forget new products, right? Products at the top would basically continue to dominate the ranking, right? Like, imagine, can products in the fourth row, like, or on the second page, right, manage to come to the first page, right? Pretty much no, because these products will gather some amount of revenue. And therefore, you know, your ranking will be static. And what you'll find is that your page is actually slowly and slowly losing revenue, right? And basically, the overall revenue for the site is going to go down. So how do we solve the problem, right? Like, so one thing that's clear is that revenue alone is not important. Impressions are equally important, right? So you not only need to look at revenue, you need to start tracking product impressions. And the reason you need to do that is you need to know how many times was a product shown and how many times was it bought. Right? Otherwise, you cannot handle presentation bias. So let's try to redefine sellability, right? So we said we'll not take all-time revenue. We will take revenue weighted by recency. So let's say our time-weighted revenue is revenue weighted by recency, right? Let's come up with a formula for that. I'll leave it to you guys to do that. And then we say sellability is basically a function of time-weighted revenue and the number of impressions that a product got, right? Like one thing I want to mention over here is tracking impressions is a non-trivial problem, right? Like you want to know whenever a particular product came into the view of a user, right? You want to know that. It could be somewhere at the bottom of the screen or top of the screen. like whenever it was shown, right, you want to track that impression. And what is equally useful is actually to track and make note of the position in which those products were shown as well, right? So who can tell me what this, I mean, what would be a simple function for sellability? How would you define F? Anybody? Yeah, so that's, you could basically take the time-weighted revenue divided by the impressions, right? So that gives a good handle over how a product is performing. And with this approach, right, what you can do is, even if newer products, right, the moment they start getting impressions, and if they, these impressions convert, right, you can quickly sort of, you know, move them to the top. But you need to do one more thing, right, which is that the algorithm not only needs to, you know, define sellability, but it also needs to create scope for products to get impressions, which is different from the ranking itself, right? Like, how are you going to introduce these products into the ranking stream, onto the pages, so that you start getting, you know, impressions for these products. So is that enough? Let's say that we've handled all of these, right? So is that going to be enough? So right now, our sellability is sort of a nice machine learning algorithm, which is based on the past performance of products, right? Now, what if we offered discount on the product, right? So the question is, does sellability remain the same? Anybody? Sorry? Yeah, sellability possibly increases, right? So just take a quick example, right? If the product is iPhone 6, but at a 30% discount, right? How much do you think the sellability will increase? What's multiple, sorry? 10x, okay. 1000x, okay, right? So there are a lot of Apple fanboys probably, you know, waiting for that 30% discount to buy the iPhone. So let's say I'm a little more conservative, right? Coming from Google, so I say 2x, right? So one could expect maybe 2x increase in sellability for iPhone 6 at the discount. So how did we determine 2 as opposed to 10 or opposed to 1000, right? We don't have any past data. So there is a need to come up with a scheme to determine this number, right? And is this number going to hold true for all products? Is it the case that if I give 30% discount on another mobile phone, is sellability going to increase by the same factor? Right? Can one expect the same kind of increase in sellability? No, right? So actually, this brings us to an interesting question, right? What is actually a document in the e-commerce world? Right? In the web world, we know that every web page is a document. So we were thinking that a product is basically a document in the e-commerce world. But as we can see, right, attributes like sellability is not a function of the product alone, right? A product at every price point actually has a totally different sellability. So maybe should we model our document as a tuple, as something which comprises of both product and price? Let's say we do that, right? What about SKUs, right? A dress of a particular size, right, may perform better than the same dress at a different size, right? A L-size dress might actually be performing better than a S-size dress, right, for exactly the same model, right? So should my document be a combination of product, SKU ID, and price? So I just wanted to know, just bring this to your attention to think about, like, when you're designing an e-commerce search engine, right, you need to look at your application. And right from defining what your document is, right, there is going to be repercussions on how you model your ranking algorithm as you go forward, right? Let's take a query now, right? Suppose you basically, like based on whatever we've discussed so far, right? Let's say we've implemented a ranking algorithm. It handles, you know, past data. Let's say it handles sellability. Let's say it handles price variations and all of that, right? Now, we've seen this query at Kmart, which is one of our customers. You see a query called frozen, right? And when we actually were launching our search on their site, the result shown was frozen fish, frozen vegetables, and, you know, ice cream, right? So I said a query frozen in time, but to me, really, it's results frozen in time because this happened in the meantime, right? The frozen movie got released, right? And when users type in frozen, no longer are they looking for frozen food, right? So what are they looking for? So they are looking for frozen merchandising items, right? So they're looking for frozen dress, toys, you know, other accessories with, you know, frozen with frozen on it, right? So basically the meaning of the query has changed over time. And if you were plainly look okay, so the e-commerce search engine had got it wrong, right? Let's look at what Google did, right? If you were to go and query on Google saying frozen, right, it wouldn't show you frozen foods, right? Even before the movie was launched, it would be showing basically the Disney Frozen movie related results, right? So how did Google get it right? Because Google is learning from the web, right? Just before the movie was launched, Google basically Disney would, you know, create a number of pages around Frozen. There'll be a lot of review articles on Frozen or articles with expectation about Frozen going to be released. There's some buzz in the news. Then there are social media mentions. And also there's user query interest around Frozen. And then you're looking at the results stream, right? Google can learn that Frozen no longer means frozen food products, but or the other meanings of Frozen, but the movie Frozen, right? Now, why did our e-commerce search get it wrong? Or a typical e-commerce search engine get it wrong? Because the park is too small. So which park is too small? Basically, Kabban Park, right? We said that e-commerce search is looking at a corpus which is as small as Kabban Park, right? So you pretty much cannot learn from just the corpus of 1 million documents, right? So query understanding does require mining the web and other social data streams. So in other words, right, in order to build an e-commerce search engine, you can't just you can't just look at the 1 million documents and build everything on top of it. It requires you to do web scale data mining. So that means that you have to still study Africa to, you know, basically search Kabban Park, right? Going back to our first example. So I also wanted to point out one more you know, thing about how real-time e-commerce search needs to be, right? So here's an example, right? Let's say the query was Virat Kohli jersey. So how many of you think that this is a great result? So sorry? Right, yeah. But otherwise, like, it's a good result, right? Exactly. Like, as you mentioned, right? What if the IPL season was about to kick off, right? Then this is the jersey that you probably want to show, right? Not this one. And if you were looking at your corpus, and you were modeling everything based on your previous performance, right? You will probably continue to show the first jersey, which is no longer what people are looking for, right? So how are you going to change your results? As, you know, things around you change, right? There are news events, then there is a seasonality factor. Like with IPL, it's a mix of both news and seasonality. Like, how is the e-commerce search engine, which is just looking at one merchant's data, going to adapt to, you know, changes, you know, around changes happening in the world, like frozen movie being released, or, you know, like the cricketing season changing, etc., right? So which means that, you know, you need to look at query streams, and you need to understand what those query streams mean, which means that you need to start looking at web and news and social media in order to understand, you know, what you need to serve, right? So yeah, as I said, the corpus is not going to tell you any of this, right? So you have to learn from other sources. So how many of you know what this shoe is? Okay, sorry? Okay, yeah, it's a pump. And it's called a white swan shoe on Neiman Marcus. It's a very popular shoe, actually. If you go to Pinterest also, you'll find a lot of people have pinned this shoe, right? This designer is Manolo Blahnik, and this is how he looks. And the interesting thing is that it costs $88,329. If you want to buy it, like, you can try it on Neiman Marcus right now if you go, right? Okay, so here's a question for you all, right? This product garners a lot of page views on Neiman Marcus, right? As I said, people are pinning this on Pinterest. They're sharing, you know, stuff about it. So obviously, it's getting a lot of articles, getting a lot of attention, but it's making no money, okay? Just no conversions, right? So the question to you all is, should we show this product, say, for the query shoes? So how many of you think that we should show this product? Okay. How many of you think that we should not show this product? Okay. So basically, there's a 50-50 split that I see, right? So how do we resolve this confusion, right? So let's do an experiment, okay, which is what we did at Bloomreach, right? So this is the set of results that we were showing for the result shoes on Neiman markers, right? And what we did was we basically conducted an A-B test, and we basically replaced one of the results with the white swan shoe, right? Now, who can tell me which side performed better? Right side, okay. Yes, actually, the right side actually performed better than the left side. In fact, it was generating 6 to 7% more revenue than the left-hand side. So can someone tell me why the right side basically performed better? So, sorry, one at a time, yeah, sorry. Okay, so he says that if you put it on the right-hand side, a shoe of 10,000 rupees, 10,000 rupees will look cheaper. That's right. Yeah, probably. Any other answers? Great, yeah, so he says that it's a store mannequin, and so I think, you know, so we have to make our guesses based on what's happening, and these are very reasonable arguments, right? So the main point that I want to make is that in the web world, only the right result matters, right? It's like searching for the needle in the haystack, right? You get that one single right result, and people are happy. Right? Whereas in the e-commerce world, not only the right result matters, what you show around them also matters. Right? The collection matters. Right? So, and remember, right? Shopping is all about comparative decision making. Right? So to take a cue from what you said, right? Let me call these products as mannequin products. Right? So why do I call them mannequin products? Because these products are great to look at, and they take prime real estate, even in the offline world, right? So right at the entrance of a store, you will have these mannequins wearing the best dresses and accessories that's available in the store, probably the higher most priced version of all the products. And basically, it induces buying of similar products, right? It makes you enter the shop in the offline world. Right? Similarly, these products induce buying of products from the same designer or shop or style at sometimes a lower price point. Right? So let's try to design how we will build an algorithm to identify mannequin products. Right? So let's see how we do that. So take every, this is just a simple algorithm, right? So take every product bought and look at all products that have been viewed along with the product, with the bought product, in the same session, right? So during browsing, people will look at N products and then decide to buy a product, right? So take a product and aggregate all products that have been ever viewed along with that product, right? So this is what we do. So there's a red shirt, and while buying the red shirt, the user basically viewed a red polka dot shirt, then some shorts, and then a yellow shirt, right? And then there was another user who bought a blue shirt, and also looked at a gray shirt, and the red polka shirt, and a black t-shirt, right? So now, which is the mannequin product? Exactly, the red polka dot shirt is the mannequin product. So here's a tricky question, right? So how do you implement this algorithm? So what would you do to implement this algorithm? Sorry? Right, so what's the infrastructure you'll use to implement this? So basically, right, like this is a very simple example. We took two products. So if you have to compute mannequin products across a merchant, right, you obviously have to look at all sessions, all products bought, and then, you know, aggregate along it, along all of these products to get the top performing mannequin products, right? So what is the distributed computing infrastructure you'd use? Sorry? Basically, you will write a MapReduce code, right? So in the mapper, you can get what are the products brought along with each of them. You invert it, and in the reducer, right, you can take the most frequently occurring products, which will turn out to be the mannequin products, right? Okay, so let's say that, so we've basically gone over a bunch of, issues and sort of covered how we address each of these issues, right? So let's look at bloom reach ranking, right? So hopefully, like, we've learned from these problems and we've taken the insights and we've implemented these algorithms, right? So I thought, let's check whether our algorithm works, right? So here's this is basically bloom reach ranking. The query is Prada shoes, right? And these are the results that are shown, right? So what can you infer from this result? Sorry? There's no right or wrong answer, so you can feel free to. Sorry? Yeah, a couple of them are pre-orderable, but that's fine. Like, so they'll get it in time, and people don't mind buying pre-ordered products on Neiman Marcus. Variety, okay. So let me, one thing is that, you know, actually all of them are sort of IEL pumps, right? And in a certain price range, right? Like $750 or even higher, right? $1,350 or $650, right? Like, these are all higher priced products, and most of them are pumps, right? I mean, in some sense, there isn't much variety, like it's all pumps, right? So, and let's take the result for the query shoes, right? So can anyone see any pattern in this? Yeah, there's more variety. Price reduced, actually, right? So what I thought was, I wanted to analyze, so let's say we said that we will rank our products by sellability, right? So every product is supposed to have a sellability score, right? And then once you retrieve the relevant products, pretty much the ranking has to be in the order of sellability. So I thought, let me look at what are the Prada products, right? Prada shoes in this result set, right? So here's a Prada shoe on the left-hand side. And here's a Prada shoe over here, right? So the fourth result and the fifth result are Prada shoes. And are these the Prada shoes that we saw on the previous page? No. So this is a loafer, and this is a sandal, and the shoes that we saw, sorry, were all like platform shoes, high-heel shoes, right? So if we were ranking, right, if all through this talk I've been talking about sellability and stuff, right? So if we have implemented the ranking the right way, then shouldn't we be seeing basically the same result, right? So is there a bug in our ranking? That's a question, right? Now, like, as you pointed out, one thing to note over here is that the products over here are all on discount, right? Everything has reduced price. And the Prada shoes, right? The partial order has not been maintained over here, right? So these are not the products that we saw on the other page, right? So why is this happening? Is it due to a bug or something else, right? So to understand this, so just to highlight, like, the product, the price of these Prada shoes is $400 and $200, right? And over there, we saw everything was $750 or $1,300, right? So to understand what's happening, right? So I decided, like, to understand what's happening, let's analyze what's the average price at which people buy products when they issue a certain query, right? We call that the average order value. So what's an AOV? Basically, what's an average order value? It's the price at which people buy products after issuing a particular query. So it turns out that Prada shoes have an AOV which is close to $700, right? So when somebody queries Prada shoes and go on to purchase a Prada shoe, they are willing to spend on an average $700, right? But when the query is shoes, people actually spend only $300. So, as I said before, most of Neiman Marcus users are actually brand conscious. They're all very rich, and they're not at all price sensitive. So if someone is actually going to type a query without a brand on Neiman Marcus, it means that they are first of all very price sensitive, and their only intent to buy on Neiman Marcus is to show off to people that they have bought a product on Neiman Marcus. Most of the queries on this site is always prefixed by a brand name, right? So in other words, right, so what did we learn from this, right? So ranking cannot be independent of the context. You cannot just rank products by sellability. What you need to have in place is basically a context-aware ranking, right? So basically, right, like with this, I conclude my talk. And what are the takeaways from this, right? Thank you. So the takeaways are the corpus may be small, as in the case of e-commerce, but the ranking is complex and hard. And let me say this, I know maybe there are a few Googlers here. Even Google has struggled on product search historically. Like I know somebody who's followed what Google has done on the product search, they started with a product called Google Base, you know, it was called Google Product Search, then Google Shopping. It's a hard problem, right? Even for a company like Google. And you need to learn from web scale data, not just the corpus. And then there is a lot of signals to incorporate, sellability, seasonality, and freshness. Then it's important that you track all user behavior, including impressions. Impressions are critical in ranking, as important as views and clicks are. And you need to have context-driven ranking. And there are unique challenges. Basically, a collection is more important than one right result, right? As we saw with mannequin products. So, I mean, one thing I just want to highlight, right? Like anybody comes and talks about e-commerce search, right? They always focus on personalization, right? I haven't even talked about personalization, right? Even without personalization, there is a whole lot of stuff that you need to do, right? To first get the ranking, and then if you add a personalization layer, depending on how much you can learn about the user, right? That's its own vertical, actually, right? So with this, I hope that I've given you sort of insight into what happens in building an e-commerce search engine. And some of our experience in building the product over the last 3.5 years. So thanks to Fifth Elephant for the opportunity. And if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer.
Just a quick announcement. The owner of the car, KA03MK8242, needs to move his car ASAP. And also KA03MT7008.
Any questions?
Questions?
One quick question is with respect to Bloomberg, the search, how you do. Does it include the comments? Like, as you said, personalization, what the whole entire world is trying, and you stop. That's the great thing. So other than that, does the comments for each product specific? Like for sellability, we had multiple tuples, as you said, price, et cetera, et cetera. Like compared to a document in web, you gave a good analogy. Does it include the comments also? For example, the shoes, when you said, which includes the comments for the product. People used to type comments. So does the sellability vary with respect to the comments in Bloom Reach?
You mean reviews?
Reviews, yeah.
Yeah,
not
yeah.
In Facebook or other social media.
Got it,
on the website itself. Yeah. Does it include or you have avoided it?
So reviews is generally a signal that can tend to be spammed both by the merchant. And sometimes by the user also, right? One angry user can go and try to spam, or the competitors can spam it, right? But we have far more accurate signals, right? The proof of the pudding is in the buying, right? We know whether the product is bought or not. We have a pixel. So when a merchant ties up with Bloom Reach, we give them a pixel which is integrated in every single web page of the entire website, right?
That
so we know every single transaction happening, right? And I think that's the biggest signal, right? Reviews, you can use it when you don't have other signals that can be substituted. But nothing is better than final buying behavior, right? Which we are able to track.
True, but have you included and you had a trade-off, or you didn't even include it?
So for example, page views, right, is a kind of analogous. We have not included review because we know that it can be spammed, because the merchant himself adds a few review here and there, for many reasons, SEO reasons and product selling reasons and all of that. So we've kept reviews away, right? Yeah.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
We have time only for one more question.
Hello? Yeah. So I actually have two questions. So number one is, how do you resolve disambiguation in cases of queries like, let's say, silver jeans, in which case, let's say, silver could be a brand of jeans and silver could be a color.
Yeah.
Now, in this case, a silver brand might be a better search result, but in some other case, silver jeans would be a better result. So how do we go about this, resolving this on the runtime? Number one. Number two was, so you mentioned that for the brand you're working with, average order value was a key metric that helped you decide for shoes, the price range should be different versus for a a specific Prada shoe query. Was it a business insight, or did you go about, you know, figuring out, okay, for shoes maybe price sensitivity works, or for a t-shirt maybe something else works?
Yeah. So okay. So let me first answer the second question, right? So I mean, the way you come to that conclusion is simple. For every query, look at the products bought, the basket value. So there are a class of queries where the purchase for those queries is really high, right? So let's say somebody was going to give a certain query and they are going to buy something for $1,000, right? You need to get your ranking right. Absolutely right. Of course, the volume also matters. You know, in the Google Ads world, there used to be certain keywords, you know, which is like legal keywords, and the bidding for those keywords used to be really, really high. Because if that guy comes in, he's going to make $1 million, the lawyer. So he'll bid it for like $50, $100, all of that, right? If he, like for that click, right? I mean, there could be a spam click too, right? So what we do is we analyze queries, and we bucket them into different categories, right? Some queries will be high volume, low revenue. Some queries will be low volume, high revenue, right? And it's the final revenue that matters for the company, for the merchant. So it's all automated. So we do nothing which is basically manual. So the algorithm takes care of, you know, identifying these different types of queries and optimizing on that, right? And on your first question, right, in terms of query understanding, so a lot of our ranking depends on the performance of products, right? So let's say we have the ability to sort of do query understanding and take brand out, so we can make it an optional parameter, and when we show both these products, right, we can pretty much learn which products are getting bought, right, which products are not getting bought. So with that, we can come to a conclusion that, okay, this actually means, for example, we have a similar query, which is Red Valentino shoes. And Red Valentino is a brand. And Valentino is also a brand. So does the user want Valentino shoes that are red, or they want the brand, the shoes from the brand Red Valentino, right? Like, so we've been able to resolve those ambiguities in our ranking. Does that answer your question?